All right, this is the second last episode of the season called Last Rites. Yay! We're gonna miss this show.
I'm gonna miss the weekly nightmares. Because even if I don't watch it on Sunday night, I get nightmares.
I don't get nightmares, but I'm still gonna miss it. So, a bunch of interesting, fun things happen. Characters come back that we've only ever seen once. Get ready for it. I love this scene. But anyways, starting off, we have a flashback sequence running through the episode, and it's of Satrakhan's past, and it turns out that after he got out of these concentration camps, he finds a wife who actually knows about vampires.
And they hunt together!
She actually walks on a crutch, so I don't know what
she... It's kind of alluded that she's lost the use of her leg because of the hunting, because he's like, oh, you know, we've all sacrificed things, you more than some.
So anyways, she's kind of housebound.
I like the scene when he's like, oh, you know, he's here. I know German Nazi vampire's here. I'm gonna go find him. And she's just like, if there's nesting,
you leave.
She's like, yeah.
And he's like, yeah, I'll be back by sunset. No
and I know
problem.
You want a family. We're gonna adopt two kids, a boy and a girl. And that's basically like saying, I have one more day until retirement. You know this ain't gonna end well.
So he buys the horse. I felt so sorry for
that
horse.
That horse be doomed.
I was like, oh, it's such a cute horse.
Gosh, oh, god damn, okay.
So he buys this horse and off he goes to climb down this well.
Why is it always a well?
I don't know. He so uses a rope to climb down this well and in he goes into this tunnel system.
And the camera keeps focusing on this rope. So that's basically saying to you, guess what? When he comes back, it's not going to be there.
There's going to be no rope. So he goes through the tunnels and nothing really happens to him. He's just kind of wandering around until he runs into, I don't know, I couldn't tell whether it was the master.
No, it was because it's kind of been said earlier in the show that the master can speak through any of his little subservient vampires.
Oh, okay, so just a vampire.
It's just a vampire and probably one of the more creepy, like, vampires that you've seen in a while. It's just kind of standing there and, like, black-eyed being like, you're very far from home. It's getting late, Jew. And you're just like, oh, hell no.
Great.
And so he goes running, galloping back.
And of course, there's no freaking rope.
I know, you gotta, okay. The German Nazi vampire. I love to hate this guy. He's such a dick. But you know what? He's so much fun. He didn't just cut the fucking rope. He probably stood there, pulling it up, having the time of his life, being like, oh, wait till he comes, wait till he sees it. I'm such an asshole.
I can't wait to see his face. I wish we had invented cameras.
And so he's looking down in the well, and Abe's looking up, and he's like, hello!
Just picture the guy from Frozen, like, oh!
And he's waiting, like, he does a freaking finger, like,
hi! This is great, isn't it? I've had my time in my life.
And like, it disappears, and Abe is just like, I cursed! Come back and face me! And it was interesting in the fact that when he's calling Eichhorst's name, at first I'm like, help. It almost felt like he was going to ask him for help, which was weird, but it's because those two actors are just so freaking good at playing off of one another, like, just, oh, I love them.
Yeah. Oh, and then, I don't know, I'm starting to develop a real problem with time lapses. It started with watching Aragorn again, and now it's just pissed me off, because he's in the bottom of the well, the sun has literally just set, and then Abe finally climbs out of the well, and it's dawn.
I think it's because it's the whole idea that he spent all, like, if you looked at his hands when he's climbing out of the well, they're all bloody. So I kind of read it as he spent the entire night trying to claw his way out of this well.
I feel like he spent a lot more time standing there screaming and doing nothing. And then like 2 hours before dawn approached, he decided that he was going to try and climb out of the fucking well.
I like my version.
I know
better.
You
it's
like
more
yours
heroic,
better.
But okay. What I wanted to know is, okay, so you got him trapped in the bottom of the well. He's now trying to claw his way up the top of the well. You have how many nesting vampires at the bottom of the well? Why don't, if I was the master, this is how I would play it. Let your freaking little lackey, the German Nazi vampire, have his moment to be like, ha ha ha, your life sucks, asshole, and let him prance off to do whatever the hell he wants to do. Give, like, Abe, like, 45 minutes of I'm gonna climb out of this well. Then send in your horde. Finish the job. Save yourself, I don't know, how many years of trouble?
Yeah, you'd think that's what he'd do, but he doesn't, you know what, he probably just doesn't see Abe as a threat, because he's never even really gotten close. Like, he knows about him, he kind of kills off a bunch of minions, but in the end, what has he really ever done?
I think it's more along the lines that he's like a theatrical asshole, this whole master thing.
Oh yeah.
But, because it is alluded, not really alluded, it's said earlier that, because he has the sword, right, and he has the sword in this scene, and supposedly that sword belonged to one of the master's, like, main minions. So he did do that. He killed that guy. He threw that guy into the frickin' Antarctic. So he has done something.
But in the end, it's just like, oh, lost a minion. Like, he's never actually gotten close to the master.
So Abe has climbed out of the hole.
It is now dawn, which irks me.
And as he's climbing out of the hole, you hear... Bzz, 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 bzz. And you know what that means.
It's the dead horse.
The horse has been gutted. And they didn't even feed off of it. Like, you know, that's just the German Nazi vampire. Like, yes, I'm going to take up his rope. I'm going to wave at him and I'm going to, like, kill his horse and just leave it there. It's going to be awesome.
You know what would have been, like, more terrifying, though, is if you could hear the horse screaming.
Yeah.
Which would have been, like, traumatizing for me on every level possible, but just... That would have been a...
Like anyway. Me with the vampire in the tunnel?
Yeah.
So he basically runs back to the village and finds his house just ransacked.
His wife's gone.
And he just like sits there and you know it's coming. And you know it's coming. And you don't want it. And you know it's coming. Because when the sun finally sets and the door opens...
In walks his wife with two vampire children. Like, we can start a family now. And you're like, oh, this is so shitty. So heartbreaking.
Oh my god. Just so well done. So well done. And
they're like clicking and
moving.
And it's just like, there's only one thing for him to do, and that's to take an axe to her. And the interesting thing about this kind of sequence is it's kind of interspersed with what's happening in the present. And that's kind of where you get this real emotional power. So we'll get back to this, like, one scene where he has to...
The actual killing scene. We'll do that, like, when we after. Get to the thing. Okay.
Yeah.
So, meanwhile, in main timeline, our group of friends are like, we have a map, okay, this is where we probably were, and okay, we gotta figure this out. And everybody's just like, fuck, okay, we've had a setback, but we gotta keep working. Meanwhile, guys, did you guys see how Satrakhan was acting in the tunnels? Like,
man, he was really having a breakdown there. Can we trust him?
We shouldn't listen to him. And everybody just kind of turns and looks, just like, he's been doing this for a long time, says the rat catcher. Of course he's going to have a bit of a, you know, a breakdown, a freak out.
And then everybody else, especially the audience, is going, you know, I seem to recall a screaming idiot running down a tunnel going, Kelly, where are you?
And Nora's just like, yeah, I agree with Vasily here. Like, imagine if this was what you were doing for your life. Oh, you know, he probably, meanwhile, like, freaking Abe's in the corner just kind of like drinking. And so F is trying to stir shit because F needs to be in charge. And then they hear a banging on the door. Who is it?
It's Kesha!
With a whole bunch of technological shit.
She's like, okay, got my stuff, guys. And they're like, you're back! And she's like, I'm back.
And F's just like, oh, you. And you're just like, fuck! And she's like, oh, I have a plan. We're gonna, like, you know the whole, like, this is always a test, emergency system. We're gonna get you on there. Look at Kesha. She's overcoming her issues with F because she knows that he has a reputation and is smart to put him on air because people will recognize him. And meanwhile, he's just being an asshole.
So there's this whole kind of thing as they're going through trying to set up the system. She sets it up. She and Vasily have their moment where...
They flirt.
And they flirt hardcore. She tells him her life story because he asks. And then he's like, I thought you only dated... Or do you only date women? And she's like, no, I only end up in crazy, passionate relationships. And he's like...
Those are the best.
So this is a thing, huh? And you're like, damn it.
Stop. Stop making me like you.
Oh, he's adorable.
I also found out that he is from Thunder Bay, so he is Canadian. So Canadian pride.
Yeah, the show is just rife with Canada stuff.
I love it. But, so we get F on air, they get taken down, la 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 la, big show.
Like, he was talking so fucking slowly, I wanted to punch him. Just, he's like, so, there's this thing.
That's happening.
Going down.
A disease.
You know?
If people get infected and they change into, like, monsters.
Maybe. So there's something you should probably be doing. Beep!
He got to, like, you know, like, silver, I think, or something, like, something that would be useless if you don't know the second half of the sentence.
Or he said something, like, stupid, like, stay in your homes. Or, like, not even that. Ugh. It's just, like, can we get to the important, like, he's actually, like, reading off this script, and it's, like, he should have just been
this vlog has just turned into reasons why we hate F. Yes. And of course, you know, they finish this up, and then what happens? We are screaming from upstairs, and we run upstairs, and someone who we haven't seen since episode 4 is back.
In all his crazy rocker glory.
And he still has, like, I love that he's still wearing the wig. Like, it's just like, I have a wig.
It kind of makes him scarier for you. Yeah. It's like, just Marilyn Manson coming at you, and you're like...
And he is chowing down on Nora's mother.
That's it. That's all there is, right? So they pick up Nora's mother, they race downstairs, barricade themselves in the basement, and they're like, well, we can't, like, just carry her because she's just, you know, she's eventually going to turn and we can't deal with this. Like, we've got to put her down.
And so while this is going on, Satrakhan, I, like, just cycle through every character in the show. It's just, like, we gotta, like, abandon ship. We gotta get out of here. We gotta go. And it's, like, we can't go through the front door because the German Nazi vampire and all of his glory. I love this guy. Like, he's still humanized. Like, you are running with a pack of fully transformed vampires who don't, like...
Who don't care about their appearance, let's be real.
And yet you probably still spent, like, 2.5 hours putting on your makeup. Is this because you want... Maybe it's because he wants to track him to be like, to recognize him, so it's like, you'll know who kills you. It's not just gonna be like some random vampire on the street. But they're like, I'm coming for you, June! Just like, oh, this guy!
And you're just kind of standing up there like, I'm coming!
Meanwhile, the vampires are like milling around, like trying to break in, and we both talked about this. The fully transformed vampires aren't that scary.
They're just kind of like, like, they haven't seen the sun, and they've all shaved their heads. It's about all you got going.
They just look like they're wearing rubber heads.
I don't know, maybe when their stinger comes out, the, like, face will peel back or something, hopefully.
But, like, transformation, where they're, like, clicky and, like, don't know how to walk, that's scary.
That is terrifying.
And so they're like, oh, what are we gonna do? And Abe's like, we're gonna take the back door through the meat cellar.
You're like, we have a meat cellar?
We have a back door.
I don't know how I feel about this.
Take all the weapons. Part of me, now there's this, like, voice in the back of my head that's like, there's no meat cellar. He's getting them in, like, this locked room so he can, like, sacrifice himself because he knows that all, like, the German Nazi vampire wants is him. And that was, like, this weird, like,
yes. You're a very dark person.
Well, okay. Think about this in, like, TV form. This is the last episode before the season finale. All of the stakes have to be set up. What would make more sense than to lose the guy who knows everything?
So, basically what they do is they kind of intersperse Satrakhan's backstory of him killing his wife to Nora having to be the one to release her mother.
Now, it's well done because F, being F, who does not... think very much of Nora. Like, he's just like, oh yes, Nora, you're my favorite person in the whole wide world, but he doesn't. He takes a machete, and he's like, go, Nora, and she's just, like, freaking out and grieving, like, oh, I can't leave her this way, and it's basically F gonna be like, I'm gonna behead her, and she grabs it from him, sends him out, and she's standing there with the machete. So Satrakhan is standing 4 feet behind, watching what's about to go down.
And so you get this flashback of him actually cutting his wife's heart out.
Which was weird for me because it bugged me through the season. How did he get the heart in the jar? Like, the entire thing. Like, I'm like, okay, you can't really, like...
That's kind of squishy.
Like, freaking Indiana Jones, like, stick your hand in that. You are sticking your hand into worms, basically.
Yeah.
So that kind of bugged me. He was kind of wearing, like, this rubber glove that went up to here. But I was just like, so they can't chew through... Why aren't we walking around in rubber?
Don't know. But anyways, it was a very emotional scene. Like, Nora's clearly, like... losing her shit for good reasons, and Satrakhan's kind of almost working through his crap, mm-hmm. watching her go through it.
The actress playing Nora did a fucking phenomenal job.
Oh, she did. Just, you could feel just how angry and sad she was at the same time.
And just disturbed, and just every emotion.
Under the sun. Okay, so that was kind of the big finale of the show, but we're gonna...
about the vampires. I forgot one thing. Through the entire season, the German Nazi vampire has been calling Satrakhan by his number from the concentration camp. And so they've left.
Hold on, little story. I don't know why. I was trying to watch it online, and I got, I think it was German subtitles, actually. Yeah, and every time he'd be, like, giving the number, like, 85210, it was off by one number, which was really funny.
But through the whole thing, he's been calling him by his number, and it's a, like, bunch of different, like, you can take a bunch of different meanings, you know, like, dehumanizing him, like. And in this episode, so basically Satrakhan leaves behind his heart, like, Miriam's heart, and leaves. And so frickin' German Nazi vampire, they finally break into the basement.
Took them a while.
They find that there's nothing there. And he's wandering around, and he's just like, oh, so this is where you've been living. I'm learning about you. Like, oh, look at all your digs. Oh, nice, look at all the silver.
Yeah.
Oh, look how well you've done. And then he finds the heart. And he's just like, well, Satrakhan, you're leaving behind everything you loved. And you're just like, you used a name.
Like, he's finally, like, gained some kind of weird respect for him that he didn't have before. Even though they had that relationship thing going on. I don't know.
It was definitely like...
new sides are coming out in their relationship. What will happen next week?
On the strain! Okay, so...
backtracking. Gus has been kind of wandering around, and he needs weapons. So he goes to the one person he knows who has a big stack of weapons, which is the guy he sold the stolen card to in episodes long past. And he holds a gun to the guy's head, and he's like, okay, take me the weapons. The guy's like, this isn't a good idea. And he's like, what, you're gonna come after me? You're never gonna find me in this city. The city's gone to shit. So he takes the guy takes him to it's a container.
Storage,
yeah,
thing.
It's a container yard full of the big, you know, train containers. And he's set one up like an office, and they're sitting there, and he hands Gus a big gun. And Gus is like, hey, cool, awesome. And then in walks this guy who's like, I'm making a delivery. And hands the black guy a big stack of money. And Gus is like, perfect, money. I don't know what it's good for anymore, but he's like, money. And then he's like, so, you know, if you've got all this money and people are paying you for shit, what are you doing? Where is this money coming from? And the guy's like, you don't want to know.
This is not when I'm just like, oh God, I know where this is going.
So, Gus is like, no, I really fucking want to know. And you're like, you don't want to know.
Pulls out the gun, shoot me the container.
So the black guy's like, whatever. Okay. So he goes and he takes him to the container and he opens the door. And what do you see?
Bunch of, I wanted to, like, my mind, I paused the episode. I'm just like, what are they doing in the container? What's the purpose of this? Why are we being shipped? Why are you shipping vampires? I thought you were making vampires. Are you bringing them from the homeland? Are these old vampires? But they're moving like new vampires. What's happening? Explain!
Well, I figured they were shipping them out so they could infect the world.
Okay, that makes more sense. I was thinking they were bringing them in for some reason.
No.
But... so begins like this great like three-way gun battle.
Between the black guy, Gus, and then the vampires are just kind of... doing whatever they're doing. But so you're never quite sure who to shoot, and Gus kind of runs away. And
so
all
excited.
Of a sudden, in comes this car squealing in, and out comes our favorite people.
Folksy!
The Vampire Hit Squad.
I love you.
Oh my god, it sounds like a band. Folksy and the Vampire Hit Squad.
I love him. He just, they come out and they got these big guns and they're just like picking off these vampires. Like, and Gus and the other guy are just like,
what the hell?
And like,
don't
meanwhile,
they shoot the black guy too?
No, they don't.
No.
Because like all of them come up and Folksy's just like, grab him. And
they go for the
black. They go for the other guy. And no, not that one, go for the other one, talking out of the side of his mouth. And Gus is just like, what? And they black bag him and throw him in the car. Folksy gives the other guy a look, hops in the car and drives off. And you're just like,
what?
Did they just abduct a guy?
What is their aim? Just, now, I love them.
I knew this was coming because it was in the book. And one of the moments in the book that still stand out to me, because I'm just like, why do they want Gus?
How did they know where he was? How did they know about him to begin with?
In my heart of hearts, it's like, so yeah, we've been watching you, making your way across the streets, picking off vampires. We kind of want to recruit you, so hold still while I eat your face. That's basically how I see it. But we do have one more thing in this episode. Eldritch Palmer.
Oh, yeah.
So basically, at the beginning of the episode, he's dying in his bed, and Eichhorst is just kind of like, hello, you're dying.
Look at you, all mortal. And, yeah, just that face, really. Like, ah. And he's this like, is so cool. I don't get to see this.
Eichhorst is... Eldritch Palmer's just like, I still have faith
that the master is going to come for me.
And he's like, what if he doesn't? Just like, how can you say everything and sound so happy? Just everything that comes out of your mouth is like the best thing ever. It's just like, I must tell the world.
So anyway,
I want to meet this actor and just hug him.
Just like, thank you for being freaking entertaining.
You have been the light in this show for me.
Him and Vasily.
Yeah, I just wanted to like thank you so much. But so finally, end of the episode, Eldritch Palmer's in his bed and he's like dying.
I'm dying.
This is it. Goodbye, cruel world.
And then all of a sudden,
the master is here. And he's just kind of like standing over Eldritch. And he's just kind of like...
And Eldritch is like in like the perfect biblical moment. Eldritch is kind of like, I believed in you. I knew you would come for me.
Give me immortality.
And the master's like, sure, fine, fuck, whatever.
I'm just gonna like hold my like funny hands over your mouth and drip liquid in. That isn't worms.
It's weird.
And so then you just kind of, and then so like he like leaves. And Eldritch is there, and you can kind of see color coming back into his face. And then it cuts out, and in walks Fitzwilliam, carrying the tray of pills, just like, gotta give my adopted dad his pills because I am the best son ever. And the bed is empty, and I'm just like, he's gonna be a vampire. He's gonna run off. This is it. And instead, we come outside, and they're in like...
In a very V for Vendetta moment.
In the rain.
And you're just like...
That's how the episode ends.
So what he's going to turn into, I have no idea.
It's said, if you watch the preview, it's basically Eldritch Palmer going to the master being like, you gave me my health back, but you didn't give me immortality. So here I'm thinking is, oh no, F's going to find out that they have like health juice in them and he's going to try to like...
extract them? Milk them like snakes?
Maybe.
Wait. Tongue!
Maybe if we can like get this is the cure for the vampire problem. You know what's gonna happen. You know how F thinks.
Oh, he's so stupid. Anyways.
So what are your thoughts? What did you think?
I enjoyed the episode. It was very well put together. It's very well acted. Thank you, people who had emotional scenes. We got to see probably my favorite characters in there. Folksy and the Vampire Hit Squad.
I just love him. He's just like, I've seen some shit. That's basically his attitude towards life. His undead life.
You know who he kind of reminds me of?
Who?
The comedian in...
Watchmen?
Yeah. Like, not, like, outlook-wise, just kind of, like, well, a little bit outlook-wise. Just kind of like, fuck all this shit. I've seen some things.
It's just like, I hate this. I just want to go back to my cave and sleep. But no, I'm cleaning up somebody else's mess.
Anyways.
So yeah.
It was a great episode.
But, quick segue here. So since we only have one more episode left of The Strain, we kind of realized something. We're not going to have any TV to blog about.
Yeah, there's that. So, anything you guys would recommend us watching and possibly telling everything about to the camera?
Yes, so could be something recent, new on TV, could be something older,
but
preferably something 45 minutes to an hour long, as much as I'd love to do like a vlog about Frasier.
That's a lot of Frasier.
That's a lot of Frasier, that's 11 seasons of Frasier.
Oh my god.
Yeah, right, 11 seasons.
That's pretty much my life.
I watched all of it.
At that point. God. I'm pretty sure I've seen all of it, just not in order.
So yeah, so if there's anything you recommend to us,
let us know.
Yes.
Bye guys.